And welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG chick.
How's the hand?
Turning purple. I'd have to cut it off.
I warned you not to pet him.
If I'm not supposed to pet him, why is he so soft?
That is a very good question. So I guess he did pet the fox. The giant fox. So we're in the Brackenbury district, and we're about to head into the Charred Barrel, which is an inn of some kind. Okay. Hold on, I'm just covering myself with a blankie because it's actually kind of cold up here. Okay. Stuff. People.
Got it.
Heartless bitch, he says. Anything else to say? No. Each plate and utensil has been polished to a spotless shine. The thin-stemmed goblets ring melodiously at the strike of a fingernail. What are we doing with our fingernails? Well, that guy's all over the place. The Charred Barrel is the finest inn in the city if you're looking for lodging. Hick! What does Thristwin have to say? The young elf is dressed in gaudy robes that he seems ready to cast off. He picks at a heavily brocaded sleeve and continually adjusts the gold chain around his neck. He looks up at you. Did she send you to run me out of town? You can tell her I'm not going anywhere without that medallion. I told Cyril I wouldn't let her sell it. If that's what you hear about, then save yourself the trouble. He puffs up his chest and glances at the exit. Oh my god, number four. Luckily for you, today's my day off. I'm just here for a drink. He watches you and hesitates for several seconds. Finally, he gives a nervous chuckle. You had me for a moment. I wouldn't put it past her to send someone like you, though. Cyril's a courtesan over at Salty Mast in Andra's Gift. We've been working together for over a year now. I find a noble with more money than sense, fill him up with liquor, and send him her way. They have a good time, and Cyril takes her fee, and a little extra. He rubs his fingers together. 100 coppers here, a trinket there. It's a bounty for us, and these lords and ladies never notice anything missing. You better not try anything with me. Relax, we're just talking. Besides, I'd like to get out of that business. Anyway, we always split the bounty, until a week ago. He squeezes his lips into a tight frown. She takes a necklace off of some noble. It's an Anguithan medallion, damn near priceless. That relic is sacred to my clan, but she won't part with it for any sum I could afford. He tugs at the gold chain around his neck. And even if I wanted to, I can't go home without it. How did this person happen to have something that belonged to one of his clan? Sagani's brow furrows in pity. That's a hard thing. Huh. Good riddance, I don't have time for this. Tell me more about your situation. He picks at the hem of his sleeve. What do you want to know? What makes this medallion so important to you? I grew up in Ir Glanfath with the Shattering Spear Clan. We Glanfathans have protected Anguithan ruins for thousands of years. It's the one day the gods ask of us in exchange for the freedom to live as we please. He fidgets with an emerald ring on his pinky. But treasure hunters looted the ruins in our territory, and we left the wilds we dwelled in for generations. Most of my clanmates scattered to towns around the Deerwood and probably live on crusts of bread. He looks at his embroidered robes with disgust. Restoring this medallion to the ruins would earn us the gods' forgiveness. The shattering spear could go home. Kanna says, this is all rather fascinating. A single medallion to earn the gods' favor and so return home? Rather reminds me of the story I heard somewhere. Tell me about Cyril. She is a courtesan at the Salty Mast over in Andra's Gift. She wasn't born to much, but she's done what she has to in order to escape that. He glances at a string of amber beads around his wrist. He's got a lot of finery, doesn't he? She's a good friend. He folds his arms in his trailing, wrinkled sleeves. Without her, I'd probably be living hand to mouth like the rest of the Shattering Spear. But this isn't about her or me. It's about the 40 people in my clan and the way of life we've held on to for generations. You seem like you've done well enough for yourself. He clenches his heavily adorned hands. It was this or scrape by in the gutters like the rest of my clan. But I'd give it all for that medallion. I offered to, but it's worth more than anything I've got, and Cyril knows it. I still don't understand why you can't take your money and return to Eir Glanfath. He sighs, arching his neatly plucked eyebrows. Of course I could, but that's not the point. A community isn't a place, it's a connection to history and meaning. He makes circles with his wrist. Like an anchor, defending the ruins for the gods gave us a purpose. Without that, we're adrift. Does this make any sense to you? I'm not sure yet. He looks at you, almost with pity. I don't know how else to explain it. So will you help me get the medallion? I'll see about getting the medallion from Cyril. You'll find her at the Salty Mast. The only way anyone sees her these days is by paying, so you have to go through Maya. He fidgets with his sleeve. But whatever you do, please don't hurt her. Now, all the stuff he has isn't enough to buy this thing back. Why? I would like the option to actually take all his stuff in exchange. That'd be cool. Since he made a point of saying how valuable it is and how much he'd desire it over anything else combined. Sugar? No, that's okay. The scripts and props belong to a production of The Most Unfortunate Tale of Fabia and Bernat. Oh, we've read that book. I can't even go back there. Okay. Understudy. Stop moving. On one, two. Well, we have to run all the way around. Despite what you may have heard, nothing unusual goes on at the sanitarium. You've seen that. Nonton. Wasn't there a Nonton in Planescape Torment? Begging your pardon. Oh, it's you. Well, there's a Nonton in this game. It's good to see you well. We had a few rough days here, but then we found this place and they were kind enough to hire us both. Things have been wonderful. I can't tell you how much we appreciate what you've done. Alright, so it's hard work, but good wages. Can't complain. I don't recall. I'm sorry, guys. Ingrowed. Abelhart Scarion.
Hail and well met.
Well met. What brings you to the Charred Barrel? The man is dressed in neat but functional clothes. His sun-wrinkled skin and limber musculature reflect a life spent in the wilderness. Is this your place? It's my retirement. He thumps the bar. Used to be a warehouse back when Brackenbury saw more ship traffic, but it fell out of use when the area became mostly residential. I inherited it from some great uncle who'd never had any luck pawning it off on my cousins. Now it's the most popular spot in Brackenbury. The nobles come to unwind, and kith from other districts come to mingle. He leans closer. We got a few rough types, too, but they behave in here. Besides, their coin's as good as anyone else's. Who are you? I was a cartographer for the Duke for decades. He rubs his neatly stubbled cheek. Crossed the White March half a dozen times and mapped most of the ruins of Thane Bog. He grins, flashing a gold tooth. A good career, but one suited to younger men. When I came back to Defiance Bay for good, Cleaver and a few other friends in the Knights helped me get the rights to refurbish this place. There's strong ale, quality entertainment, and a fresh sea breeze. He raises a mug. What more could a man want? Okay, I asked who he was, not where he came from or how he got here. Take a look at the menu. Ooh, look at that. Dragon egg dish. The grandest of omelets. Those that feast on dragon eggs often find that there is very little they would not dare do. Cool. Dragon meat dish. While tough, gamey, and notoriously hard to cook, dragon meat makes for a rich, fatty meal that is said to transfer the beast's strength and power to those that consume it. So it's plus 45 max endurance. That's an awesome buff, actually. Sorry about that, guys. In a few episodes, I'll have a new headset. I had trouble separating these freaking things, so I'm just gonna go like that. Canna, I guess, yeah. Stew. Simple but effective. This stew contains a pleasing blend of meat, vegetables, and rice. Casita casserole, or captain's casserole, originated in seaside taverns within the Deerwood, where chefs attempted to cater to alien trade interests by adapting foreign recipes. The results ultimately proved far more popular with the locals than visitors from the republics, and fish casseroles remain a common dish in many Deerwood cities. I believe we've seen this rice pan thing. Yeah. Pearlwood chicken. I don't think I've seen this one. Plus 10 max endurance, plus 2 constitution. For 5 minutes. Pearlwood chicken is common among the settlers along the Pearl Coast and Defiance Bay, but its popularity has not spread far north or abroad. Locals claim that the dwarves of Talanir were responsible for inventing the dish. Given the odd assembly of ingredients, often a notable feature of dwarven cuisine, many are inclined to accept the claim at face value. There are rumors that the Duke of Osea has become fond of Pearlwood chicken, supposedly using gray breast chickens imported live all the way from Old Valia to suit his particular tastes. As the dish is not yet popular in the Valian Republics, the citizens of Osea, are not sure if they should try to emulate the Duke's rumored style or vigorously deny it to foreigners. Yeah, now I remember reading that. Cocoa. Plus 1 constitution for 5 minutes. This sweet smelling powder is an exotic good hailing from Valian markets. Its chief use in the Deerwood is the creation of the delicacy known as chocolate. Yum. Ingrowood? It's hard work, but good wages. Can't complain. Right. Naunton and Ingrowood are for Gilded Vale. I remember, guys. I remember them. They're from that home, and I heard their love story and decided that they were true, had something to do with the bear in the cave, and the guy who died in the cave abused her, so, you know, he got his, so. We're very lucky to have Dunreed Road based in Brackenbury. It makes the district feel safer. Now these are history people, I know. Gotta laugh now and then, right? Gotta laugh now and then, right? Tempted. There's probably nothing in there, though. Yeah, it's just beer. Okay, Hannah Orakos. Good, a short one. You see a woman clad in expensive finery. Her eyes flash as she interrogates a trembling wreck on the ground. Reaching into her pocket, her hand curls around an address, and she smiles grimly. Moments later, she is in a bedraggled alleyway, her pace quickening. Her braids trail around a corner, and she is upon them. Or perhaps they are upon her. The action does not last, as she easily dispenses of man after man, searching their faces, clothes, shouts for something she fails to find. Frustrated, she moves on, but not quickly enough as an Orlin attacks her from behind, the seal upon his finger glittering with malice. The woman's eyes alight upon it as she twists to evade his blow, and her eyes burn bright. Perhaps this was not a wasted trip after all. I'm not sure what that's all about. Is she a mercenary? Disguised as a rich woman? I don't know. Victor. You see a large group of people gathered in the common area of a large inn, like this. This man is standing in the midst of the people, engaged in conversation with someone. So far. He is smiling and talking gregariously, moving from person to person with ease. Well, he's kind of just standing there. He is able to extract himself from one conversation and insert himself into another without a break in his stride. He kisses the hand of a well-dressed woman, dipping her, then twirling her back into the arms of her escort. He moves on to another group, slapping someone on the back while laughing at a joke, and then he's off again. Sliding between people, hugging someone, shaking hands, he never stops. Finally, he seems to have hit his limit, and he excuses himself from the gathering, much to the dismay of everyone there. He pickpocketed everyone, didn't he? He smiles and waves as he leaves, making a little bow with a flourish of the hand as he closes the door. Once he is away from the inn and around a corner, he pulls several objects from a concealed pocket in his jacket. He looks at each one in turn, a necklace, a brooch, a couple of coin pouches, and a small jewel. Smiling, he pours the money into his palm and quickly counts it, still aimlessly wandering the streets. He passes a beggar who holds out a bowl to him, pleading for a pittance. The man stops, smiles at the beggar, and drops all the coins into his bowl. Then he walks off, whistling happily. Well, okay, so he stole from the rich and gave to the poor. Alright, let's look back here. The cook! Please don't track dirt into my kitchen, the patrons here in particular. The oven smells of roast game hen and baking bread.
I'm on the trail.
Let me just see what's here. Oh, it's just oil. Alright, should we go down first then? Pale yellow and deep amber whiskies from the Deerwood and the Living Lands rest side by side. Oh, there's bandits here. Here there be bandits. Oh, sounded like you were talking from like a closet or something.
What?
He's loud. Oh, a snow cap? That's it? They're gonna see him, he's getting real close. Oh, it's just ale. The proprietor has collected a respectable variety of bottles from around the world. From tart Adir reds to sweet summer wines of raw Thai. Bandits.
Yeah.
I don't trust us coming up on bandits, just one of us. It's usually pretty quiet down here, and that's what the boss likes about it. Even with Dunreed Row down the street, people don't ask too many questions here. For Brackenbury, this place is pretty low-key. Just having a little chat with my associates. Alright, we can't really talk to him or do anything. I suppose there'll be some quests at some point. To get rid of them. Alright, making progress, making tracks. We'll go upstairs. Nobles. House Dominell has a dark reputation, but they're perfectly good neighbors. The sooner Lord Raymond commits his crazy daughter to the sanitarium, the better. Here's pirates. Wow. The captain takes her shore leave with the rest of us. So we got pirates upstairs and bandits downstairs. I love seeing the looks on those nobles' faces when we show up. Nothing like a good port while at port. Ha! Got it. Meriwith watches you through coal-rimmed eyes. She puts her hand on the hilt of her blade, jangling the jewels that hang from her wrist. We don't know each other, stranger. Best we keep it that way. What brings you to the charred barrel? She raises an eyebrow. What's it look like? Good wine and a little peace and quiet. She flips a copper coin with her thumb. Inscarian doesn't ask too many questions. You don't seem like a Brackenbury local. I'm a sailor. She gives you a half smile. And a liberator of certain goods. Meriwith casually fingers a large earring. And the nice thing about the snobs here is that they're usually too polite to ask more. Well, I'll be going. The map charts routes through the White March. That's a DLC that we got coming. It's not out yet, but we're seeing stuff about the White March. An Ixamatil water jug fashioned from white clay.
Nice and quiet.
What?
Oh. 111 copper pans. Nice.
You can trust me.
Yes, to steal. There's peoples. The map of the Deerwood and Irglanfath appears to predate the discovery of some of the ruins in the east. It's signed by a cartographer, A. Scarion. Oh, that's the person the pirate mentioned. Meirwald? Mort Dugest. Okay, we're gonna see this man's history. You see a group of children shouting, twisted laughter erupting from two small mouths. An eyeless boy, face grown over with strange black tusks, cowers against a log. His small shoulders shake as he whispers to himself, trying to block out the relentless trail of insults. Freak, monster, death head. The boy stays long after the other children leave. You see the same eyeless boy, now a man, many years later. Another group crowds him, but this time is an audience. He tells a long joke about a ghost and a privy, and by the time he reaches the punchline, the crowd is yelling, starting to sound very much like the first. Hopefully they liked his joke. Kill asses. That's what I like to do. You see a pair of chain gloves sitting on a table between two men. The gloves are inlaid with gold runes and glow with a faint blue aura. This man stands on one side of the table, and across from him is another man dressed in arcane robes. The man retrieves a small pouch and hands it to the wizard, telling him to count it to ensure his entire payment is there. The wizard smiles, giving the man a half bow, and then empties the pouch into his hand. "You wanted these gloves protected from thieves and other unsavory characters," he says. dropping the coins piece by piece back into the bag. Put them on, and they will never leave you. The man slowly slips his hands into the gloves, a look of satisfaction on his face. His smile falters a little once they're on his hands. The gloves flash briefly and then start making a light metallic tinkling noise. The look of satisfaction quickly becomes one of concern, and he grabs at the gloves, trying to pull them from his hands. His fingers tug at the openings, but they have shrunk, trapping his hands inside. The metal begins to work its way into his skin, small drops of blood appearing on the surface of the gloves. The man drops to his knees, fighting with them and crying in pain. The gloves constrict until they have completely shrunk around the man's hands, becoming one with the flesh.
Sheesh.
The man looks in horror at his hands and then up at the wizard, who has finished counting his money and is standing at the door. "You certainly won't be losing them now," he says, stepping through the door, slamming it behind him, leaving the man on the floor staring at his hands. Not kind. And Ileana Renault. You see a woman sway, her voice floating gloriously above the court, lilting and sweet. It twists around them, and they smile, enraptured, as she palms their hearts one by one. She begins to dance, but something in her step is offbeat. She pauses, confused, a snatch of some foreign sound in the air. Competing, resisting, it takes her a moment to spot him, a small man with a simple brow, chanting under his breath, disrupting her song with his staccato incantation. She intensifies the dance, the swing of her hips wider, her feet a flicker across the square tile ground, the underlying chant in her own song more persuasive. Her lips twist intently, vibrating with the effort of countering her charm, and then, a note, crystal clear, bright and tinkling, he begins to smile dazedly as her song continues, and he forgets all about resisting. She has won the day and the court. Okay.
I shall be discreet.
Hmm? I can do that.
I'm gonna leave this stuff. They can see him. Actually glad we got the experience for the lock, though.
Okay, I guess we're done here. We're like almost done, a half hour in. Yeah. You know what? Yeah, stay tuned next episode where we explore Raymont Manor. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.